Hi there, Livewire viewers. It's James Marley here, co-founder at Livewire Markets. And I've got something special for you, one of my favorite international guests. It's Chris Watling, CEO and chief market strategist at Longview Economics. Now, Chris provides economic insights and analysis. He provides asset allocation and strategy recommendations. And Chris is also a lovely guy and a great communicator. So Chris, it's great to see you. And I really appreciate you making some time for me and for the Livewire viewers today.
Absolute pleasure. Just a real pleasure to be here with James and talking to you again, as always. So, yeah, I just wish I was there in person, but hopefully soon we'll get to that.
Yeah, and we'll make a point of catching up when you do come out. Now, I'm sorry to put you on the skewer straight off the bat, Chris, but last time we spoke, you made two calls. One of them was good, the other one not so good. So let's start with the not so good and get it done and dusted. Your call was that inflation was going to be transitory. It looks like the US is printing 7-8% inflation numbers, and that transitory word is sort of a 2021 story. So I'm keen to know how your view has evolved on this front, given we saw the first Fed rate hike today.
Yeah, well, I think clearly we were too optimistic on that. We thought there'd be some base effects and some easing of global supply chains. But I'd say on inflation, the monetarists won. The monetarists were the guys who got it right. And I think they made some really, really valid points. You know, this whole growth in money supply that we've seen over the last 2 years, particularly broad money, not narrow money. So it's important to make the point. This is very distinct from post-GFC. This is helicopter money that we've had in the past 2 years. And those who focus on those metrics nailed the inflation forecast. And we're absolutely correct. And if I look at some of the inflation models now, the momentum is troubling, on top of which we've had some more price shocks just in the last few weeks, what with this war in terms of global food prices and energy prices and so on. And the labor market seems to be tightening up. And I'm also starting to worry about that labor market in terms of this long COVID story. So we kind of know, we all know there's lots of issues with the labor market. It's tightening up quick in the States and so on. But I think there's another thing to worry about, which is long COVID, which is affecting people. And I think meaning people are not able to work because they're fatigued. And the numbers in the UK, just to give you a flavor on that, is 1.3 million people out of a population of 70 million. So, you know, in the US, you're looking at probably 5 million with long COVID, and a quarter of them are probably not working. So yes, we're wrong on the inflation, wrong on the transitory thing, and actually quite nervous. And I think the monetarists have it. It's been a fantastic experiment in economic policy and a real learning curve, I think, for us all. So, yeah, thank you for bringing that up. I appreciate that.
That's all right. We'd like to keep you honest, Chris, but thank you for making the call. It keeps it interesting. We don't like fence sitters here, so always appreciative on that front. But let's talk about it now. We're here today, as I mentioned earlier in the chat. We've just had the Federal Reserve hiked rates pretty gently, let's be honest, given how hawkish the market really is on rate hikes. What are the implications of the inflation settings and the new information you've received today? How does that feed into your forecast from here?
Yeah, I mean, it worries me. I mean, I think the Fed's kind of set for the next few months now. They've sort of laid out their stall and they've managed to get the market to price in a bunch of hikes over the course of this year, you know, 4, 5, 6 and so on. And they were a little bit more hawkish last night, pricing in a few more hikes further out the curve. But I suspect if you think about it, real interest rates are deeply negative. You know, inflation's running at 6-7%. Maybe it comes back to 3 or 4. Difficult to know with any precision. I don't think there's anyone out there that can accurately forecast that if you're looking out for the rest of this year. But, you know, it's going to soften. But even so, rates will be 0.75% or 1% and inflation will be 3%. So real rates are still going to be negative. And I think the momentum in the economy is very strong. And actually, what concerns me, the underlying structural momentum, I should say, there's perhaps a little bit of softening near term. But what concerns me is there's so much money sitting in people's bank accounts still, and it's a global phenomenon, particularly in Western and developed economies, that it's going to add to that push and keep labor markets tight, keep that inflation pressure building. So, yeah, I think it's a real challenge out there, and the Fed will need to price in more hikes. As they get later into this year, I think we'll start worrying about that very tight labor market that's going to become very, very obvious if it isn't already.
Now, the other thing that's grabbed my attention, Chris, and it was in one of your notes and it was on the Australian Financial Review today, was the immediate emergence of the R word, meaning recession, and people talking about hiking cycles being, you know, the precursor, you know, the Fed always goes too hard and cause a recession. Given how healthy the economies appear to be, you know, why is it worth talking about that scenario now, and what were some of the conclusions that you came to?
Well, people are talking about that because obviously the Fed started raising rates and they've finished doing QE now, but also, of course, because of the energy price spikes, and whether it's both the oil price, but in Europe in particular, the natural gas prices, which is a very big part of the electricity and energy consumption, provides a lot of that energy consumption in the Eurozone. So people are worried about that, and they're worried about where the yield curve is. The steepness is, you know, we're about 25 basis points steep, so we're quite close to inverted. All of that's got the debate going. The hit to confidence, people are looking at the Michigan sentiment survey in the US, which has collapsed in terms of household confidence in the last year or so. And they're looking at real incomes being squeezed. So you can make a bearish argument, absolutely. There is an ability to make it. Personally, I would put a sort of 10% probability on a recession this year. I think it's unlikely, simply because there's, as I said earlier, there's so much money in people's bank accounts. There's so much wealth that's been created over the last 2 years. If you look at US housing equity, it's up by $17 trillion in a decade, which is almost one times GDP. And consumers are starting to tap this. Their balance sheets are good. If they need to tap a credit card, they've got tons of capacity to do that. All income groups have got a load of money in their bank accounts. So they're cushioned. They're cushioned against energy price spikes. And money's not tight. You know, there's this whole argument that all recessions, you know, some economists make this argument, all recessions about oil price spikes. But I take you back to your stats 101 class at university, where, if you remember it, the professor would always say, just because lollipops and umbrellas are correlated doesn't mean they're causal. And I think that's the same with the oil price spikes. You know, the Fed is always tightening when the economy is strong. And when the economy is strong, the oil price tends to spike. So it's definitely not the case that all oil price spikes create recessions, particularly when money's not tight. And our reading of US liquidity at the moment is it's definitely not tight. And there are lots of ways of showing that. So I think the recession risk is a very low probability event at the moment. Over 12 months, those things can change quickly, but certainly that's where we see it at the moment.
Okay. Now we've gone through the changing of the view. Let's talk about the call that you made where you hit it on the head, which was about this rotation away from really growthy parts of the market. You know, we'll use the NASDAQ as a proxy, which has been hammered, and towards these cyclical parts of the market. And Australia's been a great beneficiary of that. The Australian market's held up relatively well on a peer basis. What's your view on how the equity market plays out? I had one manager tell me today that we've not even seen the tip of the iceberg when it comes to the sell-off in unprofitable tech stocks. I'm keen to know your views.
Yeah. Well, that's great. I love that. Thank you for bringing up one of the good things. I appreciate that. This is a tough gig. It's a tough gig forecasting the future, particularly when you've got people like Putin out there doing all sorts of terrible, strange things. The rotation's played out wonderfully. It's been fantastic. And of course, yeah, absolutely. Your market over there has done really, really well. The UK market's done pretty well as well, given that commodity exposure and banks exposure.
And it was starting off a pretty low base as well. The valuations in the UK weren't great, were they?
Oh, it was screaming cheap in the UK, and it still is, actually. That sort of US versus everything else, relative expensive position of the US versus everything else is still there. That story is just beginning. I don't think we finished this structural. I think it's a structural story, potentially a multi-year story, with rotation into all those things you mentioned: financials, value, commodities. I mean, you look at some of the banks there, you know, particularly in the Europe, UK and the US, they've all rebuilt capital over the last 10, 11 years. They are awash with cash, awash with capital, desperate to put money to work. And they love a steepening. Well, they love a rising yield curve. It's not steepening, of course, but that allows them to, you know, get going. And I think we'll find they'll do well. The commodity guys will do well. I think we're in a commodity super cycle, and all those sort of areas of the market. So, you know, there's been a distinct lack of investment in many commodity spaces. We've got this greenflation story playing out. We've still got loose money, basically. You know, interest rates have gone up by 25 bips in the States. It's almost by the by. So I think those themes are there. We're yet to unwind the US tech story fully. But what I would say is these things have chapters. They're not straight lines. And if I, as a trader on a month to by month basis, I'd be buying tech now. I think it will do well in this rally that's coming. But that's a sort of 1-3 month story. That's not a 1-3 year story. I think the 1-3 year story is very much intact and remains as it was, and with that rotation ongoing. I say to people that we're going back to the sort of economic shape that was similar to the noughties. I would characterize the post GFC phase as rebuilding Western balance sheets, which is basically deflationary, which favored secular growth, the growth stocks, because there was no growth elsewhere because people were paying down debt, rebuilding their balance sheets. I think we're going back to the noughties when it was more about strong trending house prices, about home equity withdrawal, about consumers spending money and borrowing money, and about the US consumer really driving global growth in many ways, along with China at that time. So all of that flavor favors, I think, classic cyclicals. There's more growth around. It's not good for the US growth stocks, because it's not about just secular growth, there's broader growth everywhere. So yeah, I think that's a theme that's coming back into play. And it's working. So it's good news.
At an index level, which are the markets that favour those sectors? Obviously, I'm going to throw Australia in the bucket there. You know, where are the indices that you're talking to clients about?
Yeah, so that tends to favour basically non-US equity indices primarily. In Europe, it favours some of the cyclical markets, Germany, Sweden, for example. It favours some of the big banking markets like Italy. It favours the UK because it's got a mixture of commodities, financials. And as you say, it favours the classic sort of developed market commodity markets like Australia and Canada. And then you go further afield and you can look into some of the emerging markets as well. So, you know, the Southeast Asian equity markets are a very good play on global trade growth. And global trade growth tends to do really well when the US consumer is starting to spend a lot of money. So I think, you know, they'll do well. If you look at that basket of Southeast Asian equity markets, you know, sort of Vietnam, Philippines, Malaysia, Thailand, they've all kind of gone sideways for a decade. And they're starting, I think, to move to the upside. So things like that, some of the commodity equity, emerging market equity indices as well. Not Russia, of course, but some of the other ones, Brazil, Chile, so on. I think they'll all do well. So, and let's not forget, you know, China's engaging in another monetary easing cycle. So again, that's good. And you will have seen that on your iron ore price and so on. So those kind of areas are favored over the US, and I think we're going to redress that imbalance between the US and the rest of the world that's built up over the last 7 or 8 years.
Chris, final question. We've done around the ground. I always love getting your outside looking in perspective on Australia. Happy for you to touch on things like that commodity super cycle that you talked about. Keen to hear your views around that. Aussie dollar, Aussie housing, Aussie equity market. Could you give me a bit of an outside in on what you see?
Yeah, I think it's an economy that's sort of running reasonably hot, isn't it? And it seems to me it's got a lot of the characteristics that we see in the US and the UK. You know, a tight labor market, some wage inflation, strong house prices, banks that want to make money off the back of this. I think what your Aussie house price inflation was sort of 20-odd% last time I looked at it a month or two ago. And these trends, to my mind, should continue because central banks will be behind the curve. Money will remain cheap. And I'm guessing you've got a shortage of inventory there as well. So I kind of think you've got that consumer a sort of flavor that we have in the UK and the US, a very similar consumer culture. And that's all firing on lots of cylinders, lots of cash in bank accounts and all that sort of stuff. And then, of course, you've got the strong housing markets we've got in the UK, US and Eurozone. And then on top of that, of course, you've got this wonderful exposure to commodities, which is absolutely the thing you want at the moment. Perfect, really. The world needs more nat gas. And I know that's been a thing that's growing in Australia in the last sort of 5, 6, 7, 8 years. China's got an easing cycle, so great for the iron ore prices. And it's a long list, I know, of commodities, that farming commodities as well, of course, you were mentioning when we were talking beforehand. So all of this stuff, you know, the world's short of food, the world's short of commodities. You're wonderfully placed. And your Sydney house prices are going to get even more expensive.
I don't know if it's possible, but we've been wrong before on that one.
Frightening thought.
Well, Chris, listen, yeah. I could spend a lot longer on the call with you, but I'm going to save it for a chat when you come out in person. Hopefully we can go have a really good catch up. But it was lovely to see you. I really appreciate your views and taking the time to chat with the Livewire readers. Thanks very much for your time.
Yeah, lovely. Great to speak with you, James. I really appreciate it. All the very best and all the very best to everyone down there. And very much looking forward to being in the country. This, you know, it's been too long.